chapter in the Bible. You look at it, it's 176 verses.
That's a
That's the most verses, the longest chapter in the Bible. Interesting thing about 176, 176 is 16 times 11. 1611. It's a psalm about the Word of God. 10 different titles for the Word of God. Every verse in Psalm 119 except 3 refer to the Scriptures under 10 different titles. And it's just a coincidence, of course, but it's one of those interesting coincidences of life that you have the verses that equal, when you multiply, it's a multiple of 1611. An interesting thing, if you look back at Psalm 16, verse 11, and these kind of things show up in the Bible, it's just kind of a interesting thing. Just have to find it. I'm looking at the book of Job, that's why. I told you Psalm, not Job. Psalm 16:11. Thou wilt show me the paths of life, and thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. That's the joy that you get out of God's word. So there's things like that, you know, in the scripture. But if you look back at Psalm 119, a couple things just to notice. It's 176 verses. It's divided into 22 paragraphs. You notice over verse 1, you see that Hebrew letter and the English equivalent, Alpha. You've got that in your Bible. And over verse 9, Beth, and you see the reason it's in 22 sections is that it's called an alphabetical psalm. There are 22 letters in the Hebrew alphabet. There they are. Every section in, like, verse 1 to 8 in Hebrew starts with the letter Aleph. In verse 9 through 16, every verse in Hebrew starts with Beth. This is the way you would teach your children Hebrew alphabet. If you look down at verse number 25, you see that Daleth, you see that symbol in front of it? That Hebrew alphabet, you see that little, right down at the bottom, that little bitty mark? You see that? That's a tittle. In Matthew 5:18, it says every jot and tittle. That's what he's talking about, that little bitty mark. If you come with me down to, I think it's verse 133. No, that's not it. 153. That rest, the jot, that's the jot, that Hebrew letter, and the other is the tittle of Matthew 5:18 when Christ talks about it. So you see that the tininess of it, just the little vowel mark. So there's a lot of stuff in the psalm that's designed to help you understand things. By the way, there are 22 sections, 22 letters. 22 in the Bible is a number that's associated with wisdom and guidance. 8 is the number of resurrection. God's word, the words that I'm speaking to, their spirit, their life. The Word of God is quick, alive, powerful. So you have a lot of, you know, symbolism associations that way, all packed into this psalm. If you look at verse, as I said, when you go through it, there are 10 titles given to the scripture, and 10 different names given to it. I wrote them down. I'll read them to you. All but 3 verses, verse 90, verse 122, and 132, have one of these titles in it. So out of the 174 verses, 171 of them talk about something about the scripture. It's called, verse 1, you see, blessed are the undefiled in the way. We walk in the law of the Lord. So the Bible is called the way. It's called the law. Verse 2, blessed are they that keep his testimonies and that seek him with the whole heart. It's called the testimonies. Verse number 4, thou hast commanded us to keep thy precepts, another title for your Bible. Verse 5, that my ways were directed to keep thy statutes. So there's another title. Verse 6, then shall I not be ashamed when I have respect unto all thy commandments. Another title. Verse 7, I will praise thee with uprightness of heart when I shall have learned thy righteous judgments. So judgments, another title. Verse 9, wherewithal shall among young men cleanse his ways? By taking heed thereunto according to thy word. There's another title. If you go down to verse number 81, my soul fainteth for thy salvation, but I hope at thy word. Verse 89, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. So the word, the name, Psalm 105, thy word is a lamp unto my feet. The word, the title, Psalm 160, verse number 160, I'm sorry. Thy word is true from the beginning. Every one of thy righteous judgments endureth forever. The princes which persecuted me without a cause put my heart, but my heart standeth in awe of thy word. I rejoice at thy word. So you're getting the titles, all, and I read those verses just because I read those first verses. I only read the one verse. There are multiple times all down through the passage where all those names, the way, the law, the testimonies, the precepts, the statutes, the commandments, the judgments, the word, the truth, righteousness, all through. In every verse, except 3, and they refer to these various aspects of God's word. So the psalm is about the word of God. So it's a fascinating psalm to study and appreciate, and we use a lot of the verses in it. The verse we just read about, I stand in awe of thy word, that's a great thing. It's thy word is settled in heaven forever. It's a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path. All the different descriptions of what God's word is and what it does and how we trust it all through these things. It's truth. It's God's truth. And it's his righteous truth. So the psalm has all those characteristics to it. So you say, well, okay, Brother Rick, what about the author? Well, if you go and read what commentaries say, because it doesn't have an author's name on it, a lot of different people have been offered and suggested. Hezekiah, for example. Hezekiah did editorial work, if you look at Proverbs chapter 25, the men of Hezekiah. Proverbs 25, verse 1, these are also Proverbs of Solomon, which the men of Hezekiah, king of Judah, copied out. And Hezekiah had a great ministry, King Hezekiah, of collating and gathering together the scripture and preserving God's word. So there are people who say, well, they think Hezekiah probably wrote it out of his appreciation of God's word. Nathan, Ezra is another, the scribe is another person. But there's really only one Bible character whose life fits what's in the psalm. Because in the psalm, he describes himself, his experiences, and how the word of God related to them. And when you take them all together, they don't fit these other guys, some of, here and there. But there's only really one person in scripture that they all kind of fit to. And that's David. If you look at verse 17, for example. Deal bountifully with thy servant, that I may live and keep thy word. 13 times in the psalm, verse 23, for example, princes also did sit and speak against me, but thy servant did meditate in thy statutes. Verse number 13, Psalm 117.
What verse?
We're studying Psalm 119, no matter what I say otherwise, okay? Verse number... Well, I just read verse 17 and 23. Verse 38. Establish thy word unto thy servant. I just want to see the title. He calls himself thy servant, thy servant, thy servant. All down through the psalm. Now, that title is used of David in the psalms and of nobody else. If you look back at Psalm 19, it's a psalm of David, verse number 11. Moreover, by them is thy servant warned. Now, that's the first time that title's used, and it's used by David of himself. Verse 13, keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sins. Chapter 27. Chapter 27, a psalm of David. Verse 9, hide not thy face far from me. Put not thy servant away in anger. Now, there are passages that talk about thy servants, plural. But every time thy servant, singular, the individual in the Psalms, is David. Look at Psalm 36. And look at the title. To the chief musician, a psalm of David, the servant of the Lord. So when you're looking for who is the servant, and in Psalm 119, over and over, he identifies himself as the servant, thy servant. Well, when you're looking at the Psalms, who is that? Well, every time it occurs, it's David. Look with me at Psalm 89. In Psalm 89, now this is not David talking. In Psalm 89, the Lord talks. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. With my mouth will I make known thy faithfulness to all generations. For I have said, mercy shall be built up forever. Thy faithfulness shalt thou establish in the very heavens. I have made a covenant with my chosen. I, and this is the Lord talking, have sworn unto David, my servant. So in the book of Psalms, God himself calls David his servant. Verse number 20. I have found David, my servant. So when you're looking at the things that are going on here and you're looking for the servant of the Lord, it's pretty clear in the book of Psalms that my servant, thy servant here, when he says he's talking to the Lord, and when the Lord talks, it's David. So my first choice for the author of the book of Psalms, 119, is David, thy servant. Psalm 119, verse 49, remember the word unto thy servant upon which thou hast caused me to hope. It says, hope's in the Lord. So David uses the title himself. God uses the title of David. And there's no doubt about those verses that the servant is David. So The only time the psalmist in Psalm 119 actually identifies himself is as thy servant. And so I'm suggesting to you, and my thinking is that that's David. Now, when you look at the way he talks about himself, the terms that he uses and the experiences that he portrays, these things, they fit David and really don't fit anybody else. If you look back at Psalm 119 now. And look back at verse number 2. Blessed are they that keep his testimonies and that seek him with the whole heart. See that expression, the whole heart, verse number 10? With my whole heart have I sought thee. That expression, the whole heart, verse 34. Give me understanding and I shall keep thy law. I shall absorb it with my whole heart. That expression is used repeatedly, about half a dozen places here. The only one that uses that expression in the book of Psalms is David. In other words, you're listening to David talk. This is the way he thought. Look over at Psalm 138. since we're right there. You could go back to chapter 9. He does it in chapter 9, verse 1. But Psalm 138, verse 1, a psalm of David. I, David, will praise thee with my whole heart. Before the gods will I sing praise unto thee. So when you're listening to the way the psalmist talks, he's using vocabulary, descriptive terms, expressions that David uses. He talks about things that experiences that point to David. Go back with me to Psalm 119 and look, for example, at verse 23. Things that David did with other people. Princes, Psalm 119, 23, princes also did sit and speak against me, but thy servant did meditate in thy statutes. Princes, Psalm 100, verse number 161, princes have persecuted me without a cause, but my heart standeth in awe of thy word. Well, David is a guy, you know that those things happened to him. Verse number 64. I'll make it 84, I'm sorry. Can't read my own handwriting. How many are the days of thy servant? When wilt thou execute judgment on them that persecute me? The proud have digged big pits for me, which are not after thy law. All thy commandments are faithful. They persecute me wrongfully. Help thou me. I mean, he's talking about the persecution. You go through David's life and you see those kind of things are kind of common. So the persecution, the princes, the leadership of the nation, reproaching him and going after him. Verse number 22. Remove from me reproach and contempt, for I've kept thy... I mean, David was having that happen to him all the time as he was coming up and getting into position. Verse number 39, turn away my reproach, which I fear. The reproval, the judgment. Verse 51, the proud have had me greatly in derision. You know, you can take your if you're familiar with Samuel, 1 and 2 Samuel, you read those things. Oh, I think of the verse passage, going the passage, not just the verse, back over there that talks specifically about. Now come down to verse 54, and this is one that to me stands out. Thy statutes have been my song in the house of my pilgrimages. Who is the great bard of Israel? Who was the great songwriter and singer? Who was the one that calmed Saul with his playing? It's David. When you think of the psalm writer and you think of the singer, the one that wrote those songs and sang those songs in Israel, David's the first one that comes to mind. Longfellow called him, I use this phrase, the great bard of Israel. A bard's a poet. And that's who he was. Thy statutes have been my songs in the house of my pilgrimage. Well, David certainly had a pilgrimage. It goes all through Samuel. I mean, you could write by that verse, Samuel chapter 19 to 30, and you'd have his pilgrimage right there. And what got him through it? Singing God's praises out of his word. So my point to you is the experiences, the things that are happening, they remind you of David. They fit his life. They match what he is, what he's done. Verse 67. Teach me good judgments and knowledge, for I have believed thy commandments. I mean, in the midst of the afflictions and all the rest, what does he do? He trusts God's word. And you see it over and over in his life. So we read the verse already, Psalm 161. Princes have persecuted me without a cause, but my heart standeth in awe of thy word. That expression without a cause takes place twice in the Psalms, in the passage here. And by the way, without a cause, that's 13 letters in that phrase. And you remember that phrase is applied to the Lord Jesus Christ, too. And David is a type of the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse number 61, the bands of the wicked have robbed me, but I've not forsaken thy law. You write down that by that 1 Samuel 21 to 28, where you see exactly those kind of things happening, chasing him around. Verse 78, let the proud be ashamed, for they dealt perversely with me without a cause, but I will meditate in thy precepts. 2 Samuel 15, verse. You have to know some things about the history, the life of David. My point is, when you read the psalm, when I read the psalm, and I read these things, and I think, wow, that's David. Who else would that be? Well, it could be 50 other people, but all of these together, not just isolated one or two of them, and what you got is you've got King David. Or, no, he wasn't king, Ben, but David is life. And what is it that got David through all of these things in his life? It was his trust and his dependence in God's word. Verse number 81. My soul fainteth for thy salvation, but I hope in thy word. I'm focusing on your salvation. My hope is in what your word says. Verse 131, he says it this way. I opened my mouth and panted, for I longed for thy commandments. He said, I'm just panting. I'm longing. Well, does that remind you of something? Look back at Psalm 41. I'm in Job again. It's actually Psalm 42. As a hart panteth after the water brooks, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. That's exactly what the psalmist is describing. That's what David's the one who is the great Bible example. Psalmist, the example in the Psalms of just exactly that. Psalm 38, verse 10, another psalm of David. My heart panteth, my strength faileth me. As for the light of mine eyes, it also is gone from me. So my point to you is that these things just keep describing the things that are true of David. His experiences, think the way he talks, how he identifies himself. Now, if I wanted to argue with that point of view, I'd say, well, Psalm 119, verse 11, thy word have I hid in mine heart that I might not sin against thee. But David did a whole lot of sinning. So how'd that verse fit in? Well, how does that verse fit into your life? I mean, you want to stop sin? Hide his word in his heart. If you know that, do you always do it? You know, there's a verse back where it describes David, the difference between him and Solomon, is that David's heart was always right with the Lord. Solomon's heart went after other gods. So there's a heart attitude that David had that's different. Verse number 55, I will remember thy name, O Lord, in the night, and have kept thy law. This I had, because I kept thy precepts. Well, you read that and you say, well, then how did he get messed up with Bathsheba? What's he going out, you know, going out trying to seduce her? There's a lot more than that you could worry about. Well, again, I read that and I see, okay, here's a guy whose heart knows what he ought to do, whether his body does it, whether his mind does it or not. So you can go down through the passages and find some things that would say, well, you know, how does that fit with David? Verse 101, I have refrained my feet from every evil way that I might keep thy word. I have not departed from thy judgments, for thou hast taught me. How sweet are thy words unto my taste, yea, sweeter than honey in my mouth. Through thy precepts I've got understanding, therefore I hate every false way. Well, you can agree with all that, but do you always live that? No. So I don't think that looking at the verses that talk about the victory that he understood are necessarily the verses that say, well, that can't be David, when all the other verses indicate these experiences, these identities, these phrases, this heart certainly identifies who he is. And he made a lot of mistakes, and he did a lot of really harsh things. There's one situation that always fascinated me. You see people talk about He-Man and this kind of stuff. He's out with his guys, his mighty men, out in the woods, and they're going to have some R&R. And they go out and walk across the log and see who can knock the other off and kill him best. And you say, that's kind of harsh. That's tough. That's not just sitting around playing, pinochle or sitting around playing rook or something. These guys are tough dudes. And you look at, life was different for them than we think of. It's really harsh. And yet, when David sat as David, as the Lord's servant, and thought about his life, thought about his ups and downs, everything in this psalm says you turn to God's word and you have the answer. That's where your hope is. That's where the answer is. So as I read the psalm, and somebody says, well, who wrote it? It doesn't say. I don't need to know who wrote it, except that God wrote it. But when I read it, my mind says, that's David. So the reason I said that David said, and then I quoted Psalm 119, is because my personal, private, individual, subjective opinion, based upon the things I've been saying to you, is that David wrote it. So if you don't want to believe that, I don't mind if you want to be wrong. It's okay. And if I'm wrong, well, it's not going to make any difference anyway, because it's God's word, and we're trusting that. Okay? So I thought I'd do that tonight with you, because we've had a long day with the business meeting and all the activity, the lunch this afternoon, and I'm not trying to, fry your brain with a bunch of deep thinking. I thought I'd do it. I held this away, kept this to do tonight, so that you could kind of see how you can deduce things in God's word. They don't necessarily always say it straight out, but you can come to some conclusions based upon what you know about it. Now, you've got to know a whole lot about David's life. So you've got to read 1 2 Samuel. You've got to kind of put it into your mind. Then when you read the Psalms and you read these things, you can say, wow, that's something back over there like that. And one of the things about that is that you can fill up probably 2 weeks of your evening's free time doing that. And you know what you get out of that? You get more out of that than watching Wheel of Fortune or Jeopardy. Or I used to name the things, the shows that are on at night. I don't know what they are anymore. So I picked the two that my wife likes, because we watch those. How about Beat Bobby Flay? We like that one at night. I go to bed at night pretty much every night watching Beat Bobby Flay. And I wake up hungry in the morning. The guy's hard to beat, and he can come up with some concoctions out of really weird stuff. Anyway, God's word's worth it, and it's fun, and it fills your mind with things that count for eternity, and it gets out of your mind the things that make life miserable for you. So anyway, Psalm 119 is a great psalm. It's got 174 verses. I'm sorry? 76. What?
176.
What did I say?
74. And then I'll leave.
I was 74 years old in Florida, but I'm 76. For some reason, I got 74 on my mind. I'm sorry. I apologize. I'm 76 years old, and it's Psalm 119 with 176 verses. Okay? 176 trombones in the big parade. All right. Okay, it's time to go home. And again, we've had a good day, and I appreciate the fellowship and the work of the ministry. And it's encouraging to see the work go ahead as it does here. And that's a great thing. There are folks all over the world that appreciate it. I've had some emails today from some people in Europe and in Africa who were asking questions about doctrine, things that they're learning, ministry that reaches out from our folks here. And it's just such a privilege to be a part of it. And we thank God for his word and the power that his word has to do those things, not just in our lives, but the lives of others. Father, we thank you tonight for your word. As we look at this fascinating psalm that focuses so thoroughly on all the aspects of how your word works in the lives of those that believe it and trust it, we do as David said, we stand in awe of thy word, and we rest in the hope that it gives us. We thank you for that, in Christ's name. Amen. All right.